Hi there, my name is Clara Elliott, and today I'm practicing working on my tension. So I made a video a couple days ago about what is tension versus suspense, and today I'm going to be taking that conversation to tension more specifically, and then I'm going to talk about some strategies to work on it, and then I'm going to work on it. So what is tension? Well, I talked about this a little bit in that video, but tension is why your reader cares. It's what stretches the story and makes it worth reading. Specifically, that means character and stakes or emotional connection. So basically, your reader caring about the character, not necessarily as like they like them as a good person, but that they're interesting and they want to know what happens, and they care about the stakes, that they think that those stakes will matter and that the story is worth following. And this emotional connection, like I said, comes from character and stakes, but it can also come from a couple other things as well. Mystery. So we are, humans are really curious beings, and a good mystery will keep us hooked for a long time. So you can do a lot with mystery for tension. And this means both like a mystery in the traditional sense, but it could also be your language and tone, or it could be sort of just the reader wanting to know, how will the character make it out of this? Will the character be redeemed? What will happen when these stakes, you know, are met out? You know, will Katniss Everdeen die, etc.? So those also count as mysteries, and those are reasons that the reader keeps reading. They want to know what happens next. So this can happen at both the story level, meaning plot, or at the scene level. Talking about the story level first, when I talk about increasing the tension, I'm thinking of those posts, the laundry line posts. And you can either, to increase your tension, create more posts or tighten the tension at your existing posts. So first, let's talk about tightening the tension at your existing posts. You can take whatever you have causing tension already, so your stakes pretty much, and make them worse. You know, more is at stake. It's not just that, you know, the couple will break up. It's that this, you know, what does that breakup mean? It will be the death of their social life or something. And that's the second way. So you can take these external stakes and make them internal. And when you connect it more deeply to the character's wants and needs, then the stakes, the external stakes, seem much more serious. So not getting into college, okay, but not getting into college and disappointing their grandmother who's on their deathbed or something might be a little bit more of a big deal. So if you're having trouble with your existing points of tension, you might amplify those that way. Another thing you can do is just add more. So that might seem silly, but you can have tension and you can be building on your tension in all of your scenes. So how might you be increasing your tension throughout, not just by editing the ones you have, but going in and adding sort of new points? Well, you can add reminders of that original source of tension, you know, that they need to get into college, or you can amplify it. So you start out with they just need to get into college, and now they need to get into college, and they need to get into this specific college because XYZ. So that's intensifying the original source of tension. We have this college scenario and we've just made it even more intense. But you can also add a new one. So, you know, maybe they get into college, but now this needs to happen. Or they don't get into college and that needs to happen. Or college is no longer the primary goal because this other thing needs to happen. So you can just add something new, and that can either mean, you know, in addition to or sort of moving on from that previous source of tension. You can align the external with the internal, as I talked about. This can be really a strong way to increase your tension. And then you can deepen mystery. So as we talked about earlier with humans being really curious and them wanting to know what happens, you can increase the mystery. And there's two ways to do that. You can have an existing sort of question that you only answer part of. And so then, you know, you're reminded of the question, but you still don't have the full answer. Or you can get a full answer, but that answer leads to more questions. So, you know, you could think of that as like a mystery. Well, you found this clue, but that clue leads to this new clue. And you could do both. So a Sherlock Holmes type book will often have multiple clues that lead to more clues, but they also have this overarching question that you get little pieces of. So maybe you get the who done it before the why done it. And those are all parts of like the same kind of question. So intensifying the mystery, adding new questions. And this doesn't have to be in a mystery scenario. It could be something like about your world building. Think about the way Sarah J. Maas in her book, A Court of Thorns and Roses, didn't tell us why people were wearing masks and didn't tell us what the deal was with Tamlin and Lucien. So we knew that there was funky stuff happening, but we didn't really understand why until like way later in the book, like maybe halfway, 3/4 of the way through. That's when we started getting answers. So you can pose these questions and it's not a mystery book per se, but there are these unanswered questions about the world or about character motivations, and that can act as a way to create tension. And the last way to create tension is to add a time limit, because time limits work really well is that the longer time goes on, the more unlikely the success is. Dan Brown talks about, you know, shrinking the length of his books. If something's supposed to happen over a summer, see if it can happen over a week. You know, he has a lot of his books happen over the course of 24 hours. And this doesn't have to be your whole book. If you're not writing a book that fits into 24 hours, like me neither, but you could be writing a scene or a set of scenes that could happen in a short amount of time. And this could also happen in creative ways. So maybe there's not a clock ticking, but they could be underwater and your characters can only hold their breath for so long, or the submarine can only have X amount of oxygen, or there's an event coming up in 3 days and they have to do all this and the other before that event happens. Could also be something where, you know, your ex-boyfriend is in town and you want to connect with them, but you don't know when they're leaving. And so it could be more ambiguous even than just like some date in the future. It could be sort of, you don't know when, but there is a time limit, and that can just add to the stress of like, well, there is a time limit and you don't even know what that time limit is, so you better act on it now. So those are a couple strategies for addressing the story level tension.
Hey, editing Claire here. I just wanted to add that while these were all things I thought were really interesting and useful, they're not the end all be all of tension. And this is me like struggling through this. And so I don't want to come off as really didactic here, because this is something I'm still learning, and I'm definitely open to the possibility that these things that I'm thinking about might not be successful. This is a practice video, and you'll see I'm about to go into the things I'm going to do to try to apply that. So I realized that I sort of recorded this video teaching a lot of the things that I had learned, and I love to do that. I love talking about what I'm learning, but I am learning it. I'm not sure how well this stuff is going to work yet, and I just want to be upfront about that.
There's also scene level tension. Scene level tension depends on the story level tension. They're related, and it's often where you're putting those story level tension things into action, but you can do more at the scene level, because in the scene, you're making sentence structure choices, you're making word structure choices and choices about tone, and all of these things can add to the mystery or the interest or the character. You know, things like a well-placed bit of backstory, all of these things can add to the urgency or the tension. So I'm going to read, this is the fun part. So I know all this in my head, but I don't necessarily do it well, and I can definitely improve. So I'm going to read the first page or paragraph of a couple books. We're going to talk about what they're doing in that first page or paragraph to catch the reader and to create tension off the bat. And obviously they're not going to be doing everything possible in that first paragraph, because it's just the first paragraph, but they'll be doing some of it, and I want to see what. So first up, I have a much loved copy of Song of Achilles. This is my favorite book right now. So I, of course, had to look at this. If you don't want to hear me read it, you can just skip ahead to the discussion. Here we go. My father was a king and the son of kings. He was a short man, as most of us were, and built like a bull, all shoulders. He married my mother when she was 14 and sworn by the priestess to be fruitful. It was a good match. She was an only child, and her father's fortune would go to her husband. He did not find out until the wedding that she was simple. Her father had been scrupulous about keeping her veiled until the ceremony, and my father had humored him. If she was ugly, there were always slave girls and serving boys. When at last they pulled off the veil, they said my mother smiled. That is how they knew she was quite stupid. Brides did not smile. When I was delivered, a boy, he plucked me from her arms and handed me to a nurse. In pity, the midwife gave my mother a pillow to hold instead of me. My mother hugged it. She did not seem to notice a change had been made. Quickly, I became a disappointment, small, slight. I was not fast. I was not strong. I could not sing. The best that could be said of me was that I was not sickly. The colds and cramps that seized my peers left me untouched. This only made my father suspicious. Was I a changeling? Inhuman? He scowled at me, watching. My hands shook, feeling his gaze. And there was my mother, dribbling wine on herself. Quite a first page. I love this book. But thinking more critically than just I like it, what are they doing in that first page? I think that Madeline Miller is creating a lot of interest in the character. So this is really, in my opinion, we don't know anything about the story. We're not in a really tense situation. We do know that he's a prince and the son of a king, who's kind of a dick. And we do know that his mom is this woman who doesn't maybe have all her marbles. And we feel kind of bad for him. So I think that the very beginning, we have this sense of an emotional connection. And I do think that the way that it's written for me is very interesting. And that is enough, just like the way that it's written is a little bit of its own mystery. And that is a reason to keep reading. This book does kind of edge on literary fiction. So I think that that way that it's written being mysterious can do more here than you could do if you were doing something in maybe middle grade or even young adult that was less literary. But I do really like her style, and I think that it's a strong start, obviously. Next up, I'm going to talk about Blood Like Magic by our very own authortuber, Liesl Sanbury. She made a video where she talked about how one of her beta readers had given her negative feedback on this introduction, and she almost changed it. And then all of her other readers said, no, you have to keep it. That's like the best part. So I think it'll make a good conversation. And here we go. There's something about lounging in a bath of blood that makes me want to stay until my fingers shrivel enough to show the outline of my bones. So I think in this situation, we don't have that language. This is very straightforward English. We also don't know much about the character yet, but we do have this very intriguing mystery of bath of blood. And that is, I think, curiosity for me, very piquing my curiosity. What is gonna happen? Why is she in a bath of blood? Whose blood is it, etc. And finally, this is my current read, A Good Girl's Guide to Murder. I'm just gonna read the first paragraph. Here we go. Pip knew where they lived. Everyone in Fairview knew where they lived. Their home was like the town's own haunted house. People's footsteps quickened as they walked by, and their words strangled and died in their throats. Shrieking children would gather on their walk home from school, daring one another to run up and touch the front gate. Again, I think that that introduction, pretty straightforward English, but there is something in the tone. So not quite like literary sentence structure, but there is something in the tone and in the word choice that's very intriguing. And here we don't have a character at all, but we do have this situation and maybe a couple stakes that we have this haunted house and bad things happen there maybe. So that was the first thing I wanted to do. I wanted to look at these examples of novels that have been published and see how they're catching attention and creating tension right at the beginning. And now I'm going to do a couple exercises for myself, and I encourage you to do them as well and let me know how they go. I think that practice is really important and that writers who want to improve should consciously practice. So not just write and then edit, but also think more critically about their work and reflect on it and try to improve on problem areas. So here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna look at my first page or first paragraph, just as I did these, and think about what I'm doing and see if I can make any of my word choices or sentence structures stronger. I'm also gonna see if there are things I can do to add to the emotional connection to the character, to the stakes, or deepen the mystery, because it looks like those are the three things that you can really do right off the bat. The next thing I'm gonna do is look at my story level tension. So as I talked about, story level tension is where those big plot points come in. And I'm going to look at my beat sheet, which I have already. I have, you know, Save the Cat beat sheets, and this is the scenes. And I'm gonna look at those points of tension and see how I can make them stronger. So as I mentioned earlier, I'm gonna look at places where I can make the external internal. I'm gonna look at places where the stakes can be deeper. I'm gonna look at places where new mysteries can be introduced or answers can be held back maybe. And then I'm gonna look at my scene level tension. So I'm gonna pick a scene. I have a scene in mind where my characters go to this other coven, they're witches. And so I think that's a great scene for me to practice this on. And I'm going to look at my sentence structure and my word choice and how I can use them to create more tension and ask more questions. If that interests you and you want to know about how I felt about that afterwards, leave me a comment down below and maybe I'll make a follow-up video where I talk about what I learned specifically from doing these exercises. But for now, I gotta run. I'm gonna work on my tension. Let me know if this was useful to you. And again, my name is Claire Elliott and I make videos about twice a week about craft-related topics, so practicing and improving my work, and about the philosophy of writing and these deeper questions. So if either of those things interest you, give me a like and a subscribe, and I'll see you in a bit. Bye.